In the summary of the previous video series, I briefly mentioned in the last bit that the group of rotational symmetries of an icosahedron has 60 elements and is simple. I didn't exactly explain why and instead urged you to think using the intuitions developed throughout the video series. This video is a sort of solution to these two problems, focusing on the second question in particular. But it certainly doesn't hurt to tackle the former question first, and in fact, it does help in a subtle way. So why does this group have 60 elements? The most instructive way is to use the orbit-stabiliser theorem, which states that the size of the group is the product of the sizes of the orbit and the stabiliser. However, this all depends on the choice of group action. There can be a few choices available. We can choose to act on vertices, edges, or faces, and then calculate the orbit and stabilizer sizes respectively to hopefully get the number 60. We are going to choose the action on faces for now. Let's focus on this particular face. Just using this rotation, we can already let this face rotate to four other faces. In fact, it shouldn't be too difficult to see that all faces can be reached by some rotation. So the size of the orbit would be exactly how many faces there are, which is 20. Now we need to focus on the stabilizers, i.e. symmetries that leave this face unchanged. Only rotations along this axis can leave this face unchanged, and so, the identity, 120 degree counterclockwise rotation, and 120 degree clockwise rotation form the stabilizer of this face. So the size of the stabilizer is precisely 3. Hence, multiplying the sizes of the orbit and the stabilizer together, there are exactly 60 rotational symmetries of the icosahedron. Here, we only choose the action on faces, but if we consider the action on edges, the orbit size would be 30 and the stabilizer size would be 2. Also giving us 60. And if we consider the action on vertices, the orbit size would be 12 and the stabilizer size would be 5, which also gives us 60. So now we know why there are 60 rotational symmetries, but why is this group simple? First, let's recall what it means for a group to be simple. Any group has at least two normal subgroups, namely the trivial group, which we have been calling the identity set throughout this series, and the whole group. If these two are the only normal subgroups, we call it simple. But how do we know a group is simple? Do we just list all the normal subgroups? Well, sort of. We create a box and we want to chuck in some symmetries. We chuck in the first symmetry, and let's call it a seed symmetry. We need to ask ourselves, is this a normal subgroup? If not, then simply based on normality, we might need to chuck in some more symmetries. But now, you might need to also check whether it is a subgroup or not, and based on that, you might need to chuck in some more. After all these, see if we have got a normal subgroup. If not, then repeat. Eventually, we should get a normal subgroup. The end result should only be either of the two groups here. The catch here is that we use this red symmetry as a seed, and the argument might be completely different if we use some other symmetries as a seed instead. So we need to try out all different seeds to really prove a group is simple. As explained a minute ago, there are 60 symmetries that can act as the seed, so do we really need to try out all the 60 cases? Well, what if we break it down into several categories and hope that we would have similar arguments if we choose any seed from a particular category? This will dramatically reduce the number of cases we need to check. One natural way to categorize these symmetries works like this. Take this 120 degree counterclockwise rotation as an example, where the rotation axis passes through a face. Then 120 degree counterclockwise rotations along these different axes should be similar, and so we categorize them together. There are 10 axes here, so we can basically crush these 10 symmetries into a single category. So now we can record all these on a table. Very similarly, by rotating in another direction, we get another category with 10 symmetries. Another obvious category of symmetries involve this 72 degree anti-clockwise rotation. This time, there are 6 axes, so again, we can crush these 6 symmetries into a single category like before. And again, very similarly, we can obtain the clockwise rotations and 144-degree rotations. These don't quite add up to 60, and this is because we are missing a big category of symmetries, these 180-degree rotations around an edge. In fact, there are 15 different axes like that, and so again, we can very happily crush these 15 symmetries into a single category. Unlike the other categories, we don't have to distinguish between clockwise and anti-clockwise rotations. These just add up to 59, because we also have to consider the identity symmetry as well. Here, you can see how counting the number of symmetries first helps, because it helps us see if we have missed something, and tells us what symmetries there are by considering stabilizers of faces, vertices, and edges. Anyway, the question we are after is why this group is simple. Let's pick any symmetry in this category as a seed in the box analogy as seen before. By normality, the same symmetry in different perspectives need to be included in the box as well. It's not difficult to see that by rotating our perspectives, we can rotate this axis to any other axis as long as they both pass through the center of a face. So that means if we pick just one symmetry from the first category as a seed, then simply by normality, the entire category needs to be inside the box. In a similar logic, whenever we pick just one symmetry from a particular category, we have to pick the entire category. We can do better though. Let's say we have an anti-clockwise rotation about this axis. By rotating our perspective upside down, we have exactly the same rotation axis, but it now becomes a clockwise rotation. In other words, if we pick anything from the first category, just by viewing it in different perspectives, we also have to pick something from the second category as well. That means everything from these two categories need to be chosen as well. By the exact same argument, if we have picked the seed from the second category instead, again just by viewing things upside down, we would also have to pick something from the first category, and so everything in these two categories would have to be chosen as well. Okay, but can we also get the other symmetries? Sadly, no, because rotating our perspectives can't magically change the degree of rotation, and there are no other 120-degree rotations. So we can finally merge these two categories together to form a category with 20 symmetries. By the exact same logic, we can merge the 72-degree rotations as well as the 144-degree rotations. We can't merge the remaining two categories, so the categorizations are now complete. These categories have a name, conjugacy classes. This is because conjugation is the more formal name of viewing symmetries in different perspectives. If we pick anything from a conjugacy class, conjugate it with any rotations or equivalently, view it in different perspectives, it will stay inside the conjugacy class. Another way to think about it is that everything in a conjugacy class is basically the same thing viewed in different perspectives. Let's go back to the box analogy for proving a group is simple. All we have done says that if we chuck in the seed symmetry, then we also have to chuck in all the symmetries in the same conjugacy class. But is this a normal subgroup? Well, the normal part has been taken care of, but we have no idea whether it is a subgroup. If it is not, then we need to chuck in some more symmetries. Now remember that in Lagrange's theorem video, a subgroup has to have the identity in it, any compositions of symmetries in the subgroup has to still be in the subgroup, and the inverses of symmetries in the subgroup still lie in the subgroup. It's tempting to focus on the second criterion and start composing these symmetries and see what other symmetries we have to chuck in. However, it is not immediately obvious that doing this 120-degree counterclockwise rotation, then another one with a different axis, is actually this 144-degree clockwise rotation, unless you are very familiar with 3D rotations. So instead, let's recall something we know about subgroups. Lagrange's theorem, which looks something like this, but all we need to know is that the size of any subgroup has to be a factor of the size of the entire group. So looking back at our table of conjugacy classes, it is now basically a number game. Why? Well, if we want a normal subgroup, just taking one thing from a conjugacy class would require us to take everything from it. Because a subgroup needs to include the identity, we have to take this conjugacy class. If we take any other conjugacy class, then we just check whether adding the two sizes would be a factor of 60. If we want to take more conjugacy classes, just add the sizes up to see whether it is a factor of 60. We now just need to run through the possibilities. There are not too many cases here, but here is a tiny bit of a shortcut. Composing any 72-degree rotation with itself, you get a 144-degree rotation. And conversely, if you compose a 144-degree rotation with itself, you can get a 72-degree rotation. What this means is that we can merge these two 12s to get a 24. Then also notice that any two of the three sizes here would add up to more than 30, and since the only factor of 60 larger than 30 is 60 itself, taking any two of these would force us to take the third one, plus the identity of course. So now, we only need to check whether 20 plus 1, 24 plus 1, and 15 plus 1 are factors of 60. None of them divide 60, so the only normal subgroups are when we only take the identity, and if we want something more, we have to take the entire group, and so this group is simple. We have come a long way, but we have finally understood why this group has 60 symmetries and why this group is simple. We have also introduced the concept of conjugacy classes along the way. If you enjoyed this video, like, subscribe, and hit the bell. Don't forget to leave a comment as well. See you next time!